after I finished, I was pretty lost, you know, because it did become my identity. I was Murray from the Wiggles, Murray Wiggle.
I'd actually just like to start by just going back to the very beginning, right? We're in a room surrounded by guitars, but do you remember the first time you ever picked one up?
I was probably about 11 or 12. I desperately wanted to play guitar, and I talked to my parents about buying me one, and they actually borrowed a relative's guitar, and it was awful. Even then I knew it was an awful guitar.
And so when was it that you realised that you actually had an aptitude for it?
Oh, a couple of years ago, I guess.
I'm so glad we were here for this moment.
It was an obsession, but after a while I realised that it was never going to pay the bills.
Little did you know.
Yeah. Well, in fact, my dad did say to me, it's great fun playing music, but, you know, you'll never make a living from it.
It's time to wave goodbye to each other. Bye-bye.
I had thought about teaching high school when I was younger, and then I thought, no, you're teaching like a bunch of kids like us. Why would I want to do that? I went to the Institute of Early Childhood, and there were like 500 women and about 5 guys.
I was going to say, like, what was the reactions, this handful of guys in the middle of this?
Look, mostly they really loved it, because there should be more men in early childhood education. I think it's undervalued sector.
So, as I understand it, the Wiggles debuted at a Randwick childcare centre?
Yeah, it was really quite daunting in a way. We were asking them to pay attention for, I think at the time, probably half an hour. The trick is to have things for the children to do, involve them. So actions, dances, teaching strategies like modelling. The teacher just does something, doesn't say anything about it, and the children will start copying them. You just do it. You don't say, oh, this is a hot potato.
That's so funny. As you started doing that, instinctively I wanted to follow you, because I think that's Pavlov's dog in action right there.
Oh, wow.
Guitars.
Amazing. And a selection of arias. Is that that's the gold one, right?
Yeah, the gold one's the Hall of Fame. I think we were inducted in the same year as Kylie, which was cool. Basically, we went out on the road in a Tarago with a trailer on the back, just the four of us. We did it, everything, we set it up. We played in places where no one else went, really. Maybe Slim Dusty. Because Slim went everywhere. He was kind of one of our heroes for that.
I was curious about the, I don't know what the technical, well, I guess it's a wiggle.
Wiggles fingers.
Well, the Wiggles fingers, because it was inspired a little bit by cricketers, but also there was like a child safety component to it as well.
The thing about being men in early childhood, when you're a teacher in early childhood, you have to be really aware of that, you know, you can be accused of things. And you know, part of, in the photos, for instance, if there are kids there, if you've got your hands doing this, everyone sees where your hands are, you know.
Right.
It's a shame that is an issue, but it's an issue, you know. You have to protect yourself as well.
I wanted to ask you about that transition to sort of breaking into the US, because you went from playing like quite big shows in Australia to like parking lots of blockbusters.
Yeah, we did. A blockbuster car park in LA to about 4 people. one of which was the publicist. But it was fun, yeah, we just enjoyed it. And then the Disney Channel in America signed us, and that was what really broke us then. In 2 years, I think we went from playing to 4 people at Blockbuster to, you know, Madison Square Garden. When we first met John Travolta, one of his people came into the dressing room and said, Mr. Travolta would like to meet you, if that's okay. And we go, yeah. And he comes in, I put my hand out to shake hands with him, and he goes, no, that won't do. And he gave us all a big hug. And it was just like a very weird sort of feeling that John Travolta's hugging me, and I've never met him before.
One of the interesting things around that time is that in the aftermath of 9/11, a lot of bands just didn't play. Mm. But you guys did.
Yeah.
Why was it important to you to still play your shows in that particular point in history?
It was pre-Facebook, so we were getting messages just on our message. We had a message board on our website, and all these people just saying, please still come. And we kind of felt a bit of an obligation, and we met some families who lost people in the attacks. One guy, Brian Cannizzaro, who we never knew, was coming with his family to see us at one of these shows. They had tickets, and he was a fireman. He was one of the first responders, and was killed. And we met his family, and we still keep in touch with them. His wife Jackie said that to take her son's mind off it, they were just watching 24 hours a day Wiggles, and to actually come to the show and meet us was, you know, was some comfort.
To me, there's a sort of irony in you being the soundtrack for so many families around the world. Mm. Almost by design, it had to come at the expense of your own family, in a way. Like, was that very real for you?
Yeah, yeah. For about the first three years we were touring, we were doing 500 shows a year. Yeah, multiple shows. We're missing out on things with our children, but we're out there entertaining everyone else's. So I'd miss some, occasionally miss a birthday. More than occasionally. the irony wasn't lost on us, no.
Is this the Wiggles on the front page of the New York Times?
Yeah, that was some. Yeah, pretty big news, apparently.
Yeah. So in 2012, you stepped away from performing in the band. What was that moment like?
It was a hard decision because, you know, I still loved it. I still loved doing the shows, but we always knew there'd be a point where we couldn't do it anymore. And my son was doing his last few years of high school, and I'd missed so much time with them, and he particularly needed me to be there. So for the first couple of years then after I finished, I was pretty lost. It's hard to give up something you've been doing for 20 years and move on, and especially something that takes up so much of your life, you know. I second-guessed myself a lot. I thought, you know, I think I might have made the wrong decision. But it's kind of too late then.
I'd already burnt all the red skivvies. There was no way for me to step back. Talk me through the selection here. What have we got?
This is just some of them. Yeah. There's more. I did go a little crazy for a while.
How many do you have all up?
I think I have around 40 or 50. I guess then there was a search for something that was meaningful for me.
And so when does the Soul Movers enter your world?
So I was playing with some bands. At one stage I had about six or seven bands, but I really felt I needed something that was mine. Lizzie Mack, the singer, used to go to lots of gigs. I'd go to lots of gigs. I'm 6 foot four, she's about 6 foot one or two. So I'd always see her.
And stand at the back.
Yeah, so we didn't really know each other well, but we knew each other to say hello to.
Yeah. Two giraffes at the back of him. Oh, what are you doing here?
Yeah, it was a bit like that. Times of the past, they just won't last. The future's ours to make. Just started writing songs together, and she's amazing. I always say I'm the junior partner in the songwriting, but I'm happy with that.
When you get up on stage, what's the feeling you're looking for?
I don't know. It's kind of a need. It's like, you kind of need to do it. You need to make music if you have this kind of, this bug that I seem to have. You really do feed off the audience. You get a lot of energy from them, and if they get into it and dance, it spurs you on and you play better and you have more fun.
Now you've got to do the typical pose.
You've got generations after generations that were raised on the Wiggles, right? Might sound like a slightly eulogistic question. How do you want to be remembered?
I guess that I helped to bring joy to a lot of families. A few years ago, we were at the children's hospital, and there was a dad and a son who was with the dad, had autism. Mm. And his father said, oh, he doesn't actually speak, but he'll sometimes sing a couple of lines from your song. And Anthony knelt down with the little boy and just sang Toot Toot Chugga Chugga, one of the legal songs. And the kid sang every word. And when we stood up again, the father was just in tears, because he said that's the most language he's ever used in his life. And it was like, I'm sort of tearing up a bit now too, because, you know, something like that's so rewarding. And so you remember those moments.
It's an amazing legacy.
Yeah, yeah. I really do think the Wiggles is about joy, about spreading joy. Well, you know, it's not a bad thing if you could do that. I think that was pretty good life's work.
Murray, you are an absolute pleasure to talk to you. Thank you so much for taking the time today.
My pleasure.